Hey, I'm Kurt Othmer from EEG Info. Opened my iPhone last night and saw a little Google alert that some researchers have looked at the available research on neurofeedback and decided that all the effects they're seeing are placebo. Let's talk about neurofeedback and the placebo effect. So one of the really common questions we get is, hey, do you think this might be placebo? And that's actually a really cool question, because the placebo is this very powerful thing. It reflects, to a large extent, the power of our minds to conjure up health just by believing that we might be more healthy. So if I tell you, hey, this magical pill is gonna make you feel better, lo and behold, you actually feel better. And that's all in the power of the mind. And this is a huge problem for medicine in general, because some stuff that really looks like medicine really has no active ingredient at all. And now we take something like neurofeedback that has these powerful clinical results, but it looks awfully funny. We're putting electrodes on the scalp and we're watching the EEG and watching video games. It looks kind of too good to be true. So how do we know that this isn't placebo? First is animal research. Cats do not have a placebo response. Let's go back to the early days of Barry Sturman in the 1970s. He looked at the EEG of cats, and this was right about the time my mom was looking at the EEG of cats over in Cornell. And Barry Sturman was at UCLA, and he's looking at the EEG of cats, and he says, these cats are making this little burst of activity when they're focused and concentrating. Can we give them a little food reward and make them make more of that little burst? And lo and behold, they did. They gave them a little food, and they made more of those bursts. Flash forward. Now, this is the 1970s, and astronauts are going to the moon, and they're seeing things out the window that they shouldn't be seeing. So there's aliens flying by, and Houston is saying, hey guys, you're not actually seeing aliens, and hey, I can see somebody walking around on the ground. No, you can't. So they start testing the rocket fuel, because their idea is there's probably rocket fuel leaking into the cabin, and that's what's giving them these hallucinations. So UCLA and Barry Sturman was asked to test this rocket fuel on kitty cats. And I'm really sorry, that's not research that would be allowed to be done today, but you have kitty cats in the 1970s getting injected with monomethylhydrazine. Again, I'm sorry. And this, what you're seeing here, is a cat having a seizure after being exposed to monomethylhydrazine. And they had a problem in this research. In this research, some of the cats went into these seizures. Some of the cats did not. Who were these cats that didn't go into seizure? Those were the cats that had trained those bursts in the neurofeedback research. They had trained to make more of that activity, that sort of weightlifting for those little kitty brains, that exercise of making those bursts for that food reward had led them to be seizure resistant. So they had strengthened their brains enough to be seizure resistant. But here's the deal. Cats don't have a placebo response. They didn't go, I believe in you, great researcher. I believe in your healing capabilities. I'm gonna not have seizures anymore. No, cats don't care. We know that. You've been on the internet. Cats don't care. When you look at the placebo, the effects are in the same direction as expectations. So if you ask somebody, if you tell somebody, hey, this sugar pill, this fake pill, is gonna make you feel better. It's gonna make you feel happy. If the placebo is working for that person, they're gonna feel happy as a result. And what we don't have is the opposite. I can't say, here's the same sugar pill and it's gonna make you feel happy, and then they feel sad as a result. What's true of neurofeedback is our results can change based on our protocol alone. So when we train in one direction, we can have positive clinical results, we can help a migraine go away, and for that same person, that same individual with a slightly different protocol, we can inadvertently make that migraine worse. We can make that headache worse. We can make somebody uncomfortable in a session. Now, don't get me wrong, we don't lead anybody worse off. We can always get somebody back out of a negative symptom. But like a psychiatrist finding the right drug for you, right, the right medication, they try different doses to find what's exactly right. We do the same thing with neurofeedback, and we find that right protocol. And we do that largely by listening to, how is that headache right now? Is it adjusting? Is it changing? Is it getting worse? Is it getting better? We can make that headache worse and better in that session, in that moment. You can't do that with a placebo. You can't take the same sugar pill and give it to the same person, and without telling them that it's any different, suddenly have their headache get worse or better, right there in the same session, back and forth and back and forth. Those are the results that we're seeing today. Are that quick, they change that fast to be worse and better, right there in the session, and we're just listening to symptoms. We're just adjusting based on symptoms. The next, and this is my hero, Ben Goldacre, who says, look, I'm really not interested if your medical intervention is better than placebo, is better than magic. I am interested in, is your medical intervention better than the best possible therapy I currently have? And you should listen to his talks on TED. He's excellent. So let's ask that question. Is neurofeedback better than the best available therapy we currently have? Let's talk about comparison studies. Let's take the best available drug addiction therapy that we know of right now, which is the 12-step program. There's some interesting research going on right now with drugs, but the main thing you get when you go to rehab is the 12-step program. So let's compare the 12-step program to the 12-step program with neurofeedback. How do we compare? Well, we did a study in the 90s with 121 subjects split into two groups. These are the drug profiles of the various drugs that they were taking when they came to rehab. We had 121 subjects split into two groups, 63 in the 12-step group, 58 in the experimental group that received 12-step and neurofeedback. Now, initially, and we're going to talk about this in a minute, initially there was a whole bunch of folks who dropped out. So they don't end up in the final analysis here. But in the final analysis, abstinence after 1 year, 12 out of the initial 27, so 44% were still sober in that 12-step group. That's actually really good for a 12-step program. In the neurofeedback group, now this is neurofeedback plus the 12-step program, 36 out of 47 were still sober 1 year later. That's 77%. That is unheard of, and it warrants some attention. The fourth case I would make for how we know that this is not placebo is that for some of these things, there just is not a placebo explanation for how we are seeing these results. There is some amazing fMRI research, and just a moment on fMRI. You can actually do fMRI neurofeedback, and the beautiful thing, this is being done at top universities by top researchers, and they get to have these tiny little populations, a research study of one subject. They basically say, change this part of your brain, and we're gonna see it in the fMRI, we're gonna show that back to you in the fMRI, and you see that part of your brain, I want you to change it, I want you to make that change. And they do, and they go published and done, and fMRI feedback works, and it's awesome. So fMRI feedback, and then also looking at fMRI for neurofeedback. A quick moment, fMRI, what is it? Functional magnetic resonance imaging. You've heard of an MRI for your knee, sees what's going on with the joint in your knee. This is functional magnetic resonance imaging. So it's looking at the functional changes of your brain. So we can actually do neurofeedback using fMRI, and we can do imaging with the fMRI to see changes on the EEG neurofeedback. This is really profound and is great evidence for the work we're doing. There's connectivity changes looking at the EEG. This is just some symptom changes from a vet we worked with. Massive reduction in symptoms in the first three sessions. This is what we're getting done in the first three sessions. This warrants attention. And these are all his symptoms taken together. You can look at his on our Homecoming for Veterans website and look at his results. This is a SPECT scan, pre-post SPECT. You notice here this diamond pattern that Dr. Daniel Amen, who donated these SPECT scans to our nonprofit, he points to this as the classic model for PTSD, this sort of diamond pattern. And you see that highlighted here, and then after the neurofeedback. And that pre-post shows this dramatic change after the neurofeedback. Let's talk about a 1991 study, 23-point gain in Wechsler IQ score. So we changed IQ doing neurofeedback, and that was already a replication of previous data. This is really recent. This is just a couple months old. This is a publication looking at 5,740 subjects. Now, people want to criticize and say, hey, there's nothing here, but this is big. Numbers this large, they blow out of the water drug studies. This is big, 5,740 subjects. And we are moving. You see these red numbers that are over to the right. That's after the neurofeedback. Look at how far that is from normal. That black line there is normal. That's that Gaussian distribution. That red line, look at how far that red line is from that average. That's after the neurofeedback. Look at how much they've improved in impulsivity. This is huge. And that's across the board. That is major change for most of the folks coming through neurofeedback. That's really big, and that cannot be ignored. So in the grand scheme of things, this needs to be paid attention to. So when we have researchers out there who say, oh, we don't even need to look at it, well, there's not even enough research yet to say that there's not enough research yet. In other words, these researchers come along and say, oh, we're not going to research it because there's not enough research. Well, isn't that convenient? But I want to leave you with one very simple message, that this needs to be attended to. Even if you dismiss everything I said, even if you say, hey, this is silly, this is probably still placebo. Yeah, he did a nice talk, but this is probably still placebo. Even if you dismiss all of that, you need to pay attention to one fact, and that is here in this graph. Here at the top, that flat line is where people stayed in the study. That's the first 20 sessions, and they stayed in their treatment program. That's the folks doing the 12-step and the neurofeedback, and the ones getting both 12-step and neurofeedback stayed in the program. And anybody who does 12-step work, anybody who does drug addiction work will tell you, if all you do is keep people in the program, if you keep people coming back, that's enough. But going forward, the implications are big. We're getting people sleeping better. We're improving headaches. We're keeping people sober for long periods of time. We are in 4 homeless shelters here in the Los Angeles area, doing work with veterans and shelter residents and doing a tremendous amount of good. But clearly, the fight is just now showing up as the researchers are starting to say, I don't want to look at this. I want to get rid of this. And so the fight begins. So I invite you to come to our nonprofit, homecomingforveterans.org, and make a donation. Help us support vets. Help us increase the research and the message and get this information out there. And for those professionals out there, please come to a training course and learn how to do this. We need more volunteers at the shelter, and we need more good clinicians who are doing this. And those of you who are already doing this work and haven't been to a course in 5, 10, 20 years, it's time to come back, because the work we're doing today is stronger and faster and more effective. Check out the links in the show notes. And thank you so much for your time. I'm Kurt Othmer from EEG Info.